This morning and glad to see again the crowd and just some of the faces that again are such a blessing and we even had visitors this morning, amen, and so we're praying for those guys as well. And again, what a great time to be in the Lord's house, to see him moving everywhere. We're going to do a few things tonight. We're going to go over some announcements and then we'll move on into our praises and our prayer requests here in just a moment. But we're going to go over some holiday plans again that are coming up here just shortly. Most of you know these by now. We've announced them a few times. But again, just for those that might have missed it, or those watching online, or maybe somebody who needs to be told more than once like me, we'll just keep saying them, amen, until we get up there. And so hopefully it sticks. But again, Christmas Eve service. It'll be a Christmas Eve. That's the way I'll remember it in my head. But again, it's on a normal Wednesday night service. We're not changing that, not moving it. It'll be at 7 p.m. as well as the New Year's Eve service. It'll be the same thing, New Year's Eve, 2 days before the actual holiday. And again, that'll be on a Wednesday at 7 p.m. We're excited for both of those services, again, as we celebrate Jesus' birth on, of course, our Christmas Eve service. And again, just the special time that we as Christians have to, again, appreciate the Lord for all that he's done. And then our New Year's Eve service as well, looking forward to a new year and again, the Lord's hand afresh. And just looking on, again, our calendar year starting over, I realize for a Christian, right, nothing really starts over, but again, it's a new year, and so we're looking forward to what the Lord's going to do in 2021, and all the souls will be saved, amen? That's what I'm praying for, and that's what I'm looking forward to, is all the souls will be saved, and I tell you what, this time next year, who's going to be sitting in these pews, amen? Doesn't that excite you just to think about that, and all the new folks that have joined just this past year, and all the Lord's done, and that's all during a virus, amen, and hopefully this thing clears up, and I'm praying that, again, the Lord's going to add, and even if it doesn't, amen, he's done enough this year, and I'm praying again for new souls and new folks, and I'm telling you what, I'm excited for this next year, okay, and so, again, that's our New Year's Eve service, and then I announced this morning, we're going to be taking the Lord's Supper next Sunday, okay, so I want to give you a week kind of announcement, so you have a week of preparation there to prepare. Again, we believe the Lord's Supper is to be taken in a very serious mindset, a sober mindset, not one that is haughty or not one that, again, is out of line or not dealt with sin. So we want to give you a week to kind of prepare to take the Lord's Supper. And so if you'll do that this week and kind of go over in your minds and your hearts, you know, where you are spiritually. And in that way, we're ready by Sunday. And of course, we'll have those times of reflection during that service as well. But again, just to give you a week to really prepare for all that is. And of course, we understand that the Bible goes over many different verses on the Lord's Supper. But what one that sticks out particular to me is says this, for this cause many among you are weak and sickly. And what it's talking about, again, is those that have taken the Lord's Supper unworthily. They've not taken the proper time to reflect and again to look at you know, their life and just taking it out of a non-serious mindset. And again, there's consequences for that. And so we want to make sure that we're prepared and ready for them. Okay. And so I do want to give you a week's notice and just let you prepare for it a little bit. So again, that's next Sunday. I pray that you'll join us. That'll be during our morning service and come and join us for that. Okay. And so we'll observe that. Other than that, I think we're really okay as far as announcements go, besides Saturday morning, as we've announced so many other times. Some of these just never come off. There are announcements that get made all the time, and just because it's something that goes on here at the church. But we're praying again for our Saturday morning outreach, and that we'll have a great multitude of people show up from our church. Praying that is a building department, that we're constantly getting new folks involved with that, and again, able to go out to reach our community. And so I would say this, whatever time you have there to dedicate, please do, if any. And again, we'll try to have a great impact on our community here in Batavia, Ohio. Amen? So let's do this. Let's switch gears now and go into our praises and our prayer requests. Again, we read through this prayer list, is what we do on a Sunday night. We're going to go to some different live prayer requests and different things here soon. But if you'd like to be on this list or maybe be updated by this text list that goes out every Wednesday, and so make sure that we have your phone number. We can get you added to a list there, as well as any updates that you have. Make sure that you're sending those in, or make sure that you let one of us know, and we can get those tweaked or updated as we need to do that accordingly, okay? So that is, again, just for our accurate records, and that we know how to pray best, okay? And so we'll walk through this list. Of course, praying for our church, as we just mentioned, praying for lost souls.
All right, if you'll stand with me and turn in your books to page 229, we're going to sing Since I Have Been Redeemed. We'll sing the first, second, and the last verse, page 229.
I have a song I love to sing since I have been redeemed of my Redeemer, Savior, King. Since I have been redeemed, since I have been redeemed, since I have been redeemed, I will glory in His name. Since I have been redeemed, I will glory in my Savior's name. I have a Christ that satisfies since I have been redeemed. To do His will, my highest right, since I have been redeemed. Since I have been redeemed. Since I have been redeemed, I will glory in His name. Since I have been redeemed, I will glory in my Savior's name. I have a home prepared for me since I have been redeemed, where I shall dwell eternally since I have been redeemed, I will glory in His name. Since I have been redeemed, I will glory in my Savior's name.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Thank you.
singing The Sweet By and By, page 41, if you're following along in your books, page 41. Sing first, second, last.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessings of rest in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Can the ushers come on the course of the last?
With our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love, the blessings that hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Brother Butch, could you ask a blessing on the offering, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank You for all the time You've given us in Your house. We thank You for Your love. We thank You for Your grace. We thank You for Your Son on the cross for our sins. We thank You for everything. We pray You'll watch over everybody. Watch over this offering. Use it as You see fit. Please bless the gift and the giver. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Thank you. and the cobblestones were cold. Little Mary, full of grace, with the tears upon her face, and a mother's hand to hold. It was a labor of pain. It was a cold sky above. Was a labor of love. Noble Joseph by her side, countless tens of millions. There were no midwives to be found in the streets of David's town.
He was the maker of the moon. He was the author of the fame that could make the mountains move.
Matthew chapter number 26, if you've got your Bible with you tonight, Matthew chapter number 26. And we're going to speak on a topic tonight that you're not going to like me for. I already know we're Baptists. There's a few things that we like and a few things that we're known for. One of those is food, and the other one would probably be sleep, right? The two things that we love. And tonight we're going to talk about some of this sleep and how important it is to us as people, but also in a biblical context, not just talking specifically about our sleep, of course. But look with me in Matthew chapter number 26 and verse number 36. We see Jesus right before the moments where he's going to be betrayed. He's in the garden. He's praying. It says this in verse number 36. Then cometh Jesus with them into a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face, and he prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh to the disciples and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, what, could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Verse number 42. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O, my Father, if this cup may pass from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them sleeping again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then cometh he to his disciples and saith unto them, Sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. Let's pray and we'll continue reading. Lord Jesus, we love you tonight. God, I'm praying that you would intercede in these services. I'm praying, Lord, that you again would be involved with us and invested in us tonight. I pray that your words would come forward. I pray, Lord, that you'd put this man that stands behind the pulpit, behind the cross. Lord, I pray that you'd speak, Lord, in the absence and again in the places that I lack and am not able to have wisdom as you do. But God, it's not mine, it's yours anyway. So Lord, I'm praying that your wisdom would be shown. I'm praying that your words would again reign true in our hearts tonight. And again, I pray that your scripture, not a man's words, Lord, that we are hiding in our hearts tonight. So God, I pray that you'd speak your truth tonight. And Lord Jesus, again, as we always pray, I pray that it would affect our hearts and bring about eternal changes in our lives. We love you. We need you and ask you to be a part of this service. In Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, Matthew chapter number 26, as I said, speaking of sleep. Now, I did some math, right? Okay, that's where we get into trouble, right? I did math. I've got some numbers for you tonight. I just looked up a couple statistics, and I'm not all statistical, and I don't always look at stats, but sometimes it's neat, right, to look up some statistics and some of those different things that you and I do just to see just how much time we dedicate to certain things versus others, and again, to know the factual evidence on some of these things. Let me just give you a few numbers. Average sleep that a person gets in the United States of America is about 7 hours. Okay, now you can judge where you're at on that scale. Some people sleep way over 7 hours. Some people sleep less than 7 hours, right? I've got a problem with sleeping a long time. I don't know why. I usually get restless in the night and I wake up. I love early mornings and I love going to bed late, right? That's just who I am. I don't like to go to bed. I don't like to sleep. I think it's a waste of time. So I don't like to sleep much, but I know that there are some that love to sleep, right? My wife is one of them. She loves sleep. We've got opposite mindsets on sleep. She loves it. She thinks it's one of the most wonderful things in the world, and I know why. It's because she's got two little monkeys hanging off of her arms 24/7, soon to be three, right? And so sleep is precious to her. But let me just give you some numbers. 7 hours of sleep on average, which if you were to do the math and multiply that by the number of days that are in a year, amounts to 2,555 hours per year. Watch this, that we sleep. Now again, that's based on the average number of hours that somebody sleeps, which is 7, and you know where you're at on that scale. 2,555 hours that we sleep every single year. Now let me give you another number. The average life expectancy here in the United States is approximately 79 years of age, okay? Now, that's different in some countries, but 79, and I know, of course, that we've got some that have been blessed to live on past that and hopefully live great, long, wonderful lives, and praise the Lord for that. But again, the average, 79 years. And so if you take 2,555, multiply it by 79, then you've got 201,845 hours that someone will sleep in a lifetime, okay? Now you take that and then you multiply it by how many hours are in a life that is 79 years, that's 692,000 hours in 40, 6,920,040. And so here's what I'm saying is this, that we sleep for nearly one third of our life. Now listen to this, nearly one third of our life is spent sleeping based on, again, 7 hour average sleep cycle. Now, how many of you sleep more than 7 hours, right? Now, listen, don't raise your hand. I'm not trying to get anybody in trouble. How many of us sleep more than 7 hours? Hey, listen to this. How many of us take naps along with our 7 hours of average sleep, right? Oh, Barry and Joe, yeah, we take naps, right? Now, how many of us take naps on top of just the normal sleep that we get throughout a day? Over one third of our life, listen, is spent asleep. Now, to me, that is just amazing. And when you do the math, if you go to, again, a third of 79, you get somewhere right in the range of 23 years that we spend sleeping in this life. Now listen, that makes you, right? That makes you really realize just how much time we spend sleeping. And again, that's just bedtime. That's not including any naps or any other kind of sleeping that we do. This means that we have equal to or about less than 2/3 of our actual life that we actually do things that matter, right? So in other words, it leaves 2/3, if not less, of our lives that we actually have to do things that matter, right? That we're not sleeping, that we're cognitive, that we can walk around and get things done that need to be done. Now, also, we know that there are some other things in play in our lives because we're humans. We've kind of got to do something. It goes all the way back to Adam and Eve, and he said, you're going to till the ground, right? You're going to take care of some things in order to eat now because of the curse of sin. And so we've got to work, right? If you go to work, the average work day is about 8 hours, equating to about 2,080 hours per year. The average retirement age is about 61, equating to 126,880 hours of work in a career lifetime. So that means if you work for, again, until you're 61, if you were just to work, again, about 126,000 hours. So here's what we are, is we've spent now half of our lives either working or sleeping, and now we've not got much time left that's actually dedicated to everything else that comes in life. Now, again, I'm not a big numbers person. I'm not a big numbers guy. But again, even those numbers are very obvious to me. How much of my time do I spend doing things that I can't control? And then how much time do I really have left to do things that are important that make a difference with the small amount of life that I have left after those different things? See, friend, if we spend 1/3 of our life sleeping, then that's accomplishing nothing. You say, well, yeah, but haven't you seen the health studies that say that you burn fat while you sleep, right? So maybe I should sleep instead of going to the gym. No, that's not exactly how that works, but we don't accomplish anything while we sleep, right? And work, I understand that we've got to do, but again, so much of our life is dedicated to or given to things that we can't control. Nothing productive as far as our spiritual life comes from, again, those hours that we spend out of our control, and that's half of our life. And so what it leaves us is about half of our life that we actually can control, that we actually can do something with, that we can mold or make or shape into what would amount to, again, be a meaningful life, right? We did a study not long ago about time, and that's not what we're doing tonight. We're focusing on something else tonight. But it's very interesting as you break up the amount of time that we spend on different things. It's very interesting to look at the habits of humans and again to see how we spend our time. But nearly half our lives spent just working and sleeping. Now, I'll tell you this. I personally don't like to sleep a whole bunch. I remember nap time as a kid. Mom would force us to take naps. She babysat a bunch of other kids. And so we had a nap time where we all would lay down and some different things. And so, again, some of it might stem back to being forced to go to sleep, but I just don't like to sleep. I believe it's a waste of time. But here's where I'm going with this. We're not talking just about our sleep as people, but the Bible talks about sleep in another aspect. In several different passages, and we're going to move on to one here in just a moment. We're not quite ready to leave our passage in Matthew chapter number 26 yet, but the Bible talks about sleep in several different aspects as not being aware as to what is happening with our lives, or not being aware as to where the time or where the effort or the energy of our life is going. In fact, as you look in Matthew chapter number 26, as I said before, in verse number 36, this is right before Jesus is going to be betrayed. This is right before he's going to be given in the hands of him that, again, we know is Judas Iscariot, right, that's going to sell him, the Bible says, for 30 pieces of silver, right before he's going to be crucified, right? And Jesus is praying. He took a specific man with him. Now you think about that. You think about being chosen out of the apostles, chosen out of the disciples. Come here, John, and come here. And he picks out 3 different men that are going to go with him, right? And you start to think about why he would choose those men. Maybe for comfort, maybe for companionship, or whatever it was to go with him in a time that was troubled. But nevertheless, he brings these men with him. And where are they and what are they doing as he's praying, as he's dealing with, again, all that he's going through and all that he's about to go through? What are they doing? They're sleeping. Not one time, but 2 times. Not 2 times, but 3 times. 3 separate occasions. Jesus walks back to these disciples, and every single time, what are they doing? They are asleep. Now, these are the men that knew Jesus. These are the men that did ministry with Jesus and saw him and saw his works. And here's what I'm telling you, friend. If we're not careful in the midst of Jesus moving or in the midst of God doing his will, we are asleep, and it's happening around us and we are not a part of what God is doing, again, if we're neglecting that attention that God deserves. Now, I don't know how different the story would have been if these disciples would have been awake. I'm not much into speculation. I don't like to give you my opinions, or I don't like to dabble in what ifs, but I do know this. It probably would have been a different story had they been awake and had they given, again, attention, or maybe prayed with Jesus, or maybe prayed for him as he went to pray. I just know it would have been different had they not been sleeping. But notice this, that Jesus brought these men with him, but could he rely on them? The answer is no. He couldn't rely on them. He handpicked these men, but he could not rely on them. Why? Because they were sleeping in the middle of him doing, or the middle of him moving. And I tell you this, friend, and again, everything that I say, it has 10 more fingers pointing right back at me. I understand this, but as a church, here's what we've got to realize, is we can't simply sleep and sleep through until God arrives. We can't simply lay down for nap time until Jesus comes back and takes us in the rapture. There's some work that needs to be done, right? I don't know about you, but if you've ever been excited for something and the only way to wait for it is just to go to sleep, right? I remember as a kid, Christmas morning, the best thing to do was just go to sleep, right? Because when you wake up, there it is. It's hard to stay up all night and think about it and have it on your mind all the time. And I tell you what, some other big life decisions and things that happen, sometimes we go to sleep just to avoid what's coming, or just to get ready for what's coming. But here's what I'm saying tonight, friend, is that we cannot simply go to sleep as a church. We cannot simply, as Christians, go to sleep and just wait for this rapture. And in other words, what I'm saying is the Bible outlines for us a specific job that we have until that rapture comes. Not to sleep, not to take a nap, not to check out, but rather to be in tune with God's will and again, executing God's will, taking his word to the world. And I tell you what, I don't want to nap and miss it. I don't want to be asleep spiritually. I don't. I don't want to spend my whole life napping and sleeping and laying about and lounging and being lazy and miss God's work, by the way, which is happening all over our world. And here's the problem. God's not asleep. God didn't change. His churches did. The churches around America are sleepy, right? They've got sand in their eyes, and they've got the puffy bags. Why? Because they're doing everything and everything else in the world rather than, again, what we ought to be doing, which is serving the Lord inside of his will. Friend, we ought not be sleeping, but rather be awake, noticing God moving all around us. Go to Romans in chapter number 13. Go to Romans chapter number 13 and verse number 8. Romans chapter number 13 and verse number 8. We're going to read just a few verses here. The Bible gives us a more clarification as to how we are to live and what we're to look for. It says this, and let's just start in verse number 8. It says, "Owe no man anything, but to love one another, for he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. For this, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet. If there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, that thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. And that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light." And then it says this in verse number 13, "Let us walk honestly, as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof." I want you to notice a few things that these verses talk about. First of all, the Bible says this in verse number 11, knowing the time. That's what it says, knowing the time, that you and I understand and know the days that we live in. And now, I know that we've talked about this before, and I know that we've gone over this, friend, but just bear with me for a second. If 2,000 years ago, again, when Scripture was being recorded, and even farther than that, when God's Word was being written, if 2,000 plus years ago they thought it was the end days, don't you think now more than ever we are in the last days? Amen. They said now is our salvation nearer than ever, all the way back in the book of Romans. And here we are in 2020 A.D., right after the death of Christ. By the way, that's what that stands for. I don't care what the world changes it to. It's before Christ and after Christ. That's what it is. Okay, and so now here we are in 2020, all these years later, and we've even become slack, again, concerning the return of the Lord. Listen, friend, our salvation is near. How near? I don't know the exact day. How near? I don't know the exact hour. But I'll tell you this, I know the season.
Now, I know the times that the Bible talks about that we'll be in when he comes. And I'll tell you this, we're in the season. I don't know what the biblical term for a season is or how long that is to the Lord. I know this, a day with the Lord is 1,000 years, right? And so I don't know. I don't know the exact time, but I know for a fact we are in the season of the Lord's return. So here's what it tells me. The Bible says, get awake, wake up, right? Don't stop sleeping. Open your eyes. It says this in verse number 11. Knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, right? If you've ever been sleeping and overslept, you ever been there? I had a bus I had to catch. That's what I had. Every school morning, I had a bus that I had to catch. And we lived in the cul-de-sac, and we lived about halfway down the cul-de-sac, and there was a road that led to our cul-de-sac, and so we'd have to walk all the way down the cul-de-sac and all the way up this road just to catch the bus. And there were some times when I overslept, and I heard the bus's brakes through the screen door, and I don't care how far away that bus was, I was sprinting, jumping gates, cutting through backyards, doing anything I could to get to that bus. Why? I was late, right? I overslept. It was high time to awake out of sleep and go catch that bus, right? There's things in our lives that we oversleep, or we wait too long, or we spend too much time goofing off, or whatever it is that we've wasted time, and now we're in a hurry or a scurry or whatever you want to say to get to what we need to do. Listen, friend, that's not how I want it to be with the Lord's will in my life. I don't want to wake up late and arrive late to the scene, and I don't want to just give him whatever sloppy thing I can throw together last second, but rather, I want to awake out of sleep, and I want to be awake and ready to meet the Lord and what the Lord has for me that day, amen? Not to wake up late and again, to be disorganized, but rather to wake up and realize what he's trying to do in my life. Look at verse number 11 at the end of that verse. For it's high time to wake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than we believe. In verse number 12, the night is far spent, and the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Notice this, the night is far spent, right? The time for sleeping is long gone. Amen? The time for sleeping is past us. You ever heard somebody say, I'll sleep when I'm dead, right? People say that all the time. That's not the healthiest advice. But I will tell you this, you'll never get enough sleep. Do you ever notice that about sleep? It doesn't matter how much you sleep. You can wake up in the morning, if you sleep in till 10, wake up in the morning, live till 12, right? That's a real life right there, right? Living all the way till 12 and being up for 2 hours. And guess what will happen sometimes? Your eyes will start to get heavy, right? And especially when you get that lunch in your belly. There's a certain country down south that does it right. They take a midday siesta, right? They take a nap right after they eat lunch. I'm telling you what, that sounds great. Why? Because we get tired all the time. In fact, one of the most common phrases I hear from people, how you doing?
Tired.
How you doing? Man, I'm just exhausted, right? That's what everybody says when you talk to them. And here's a universal truth, it seems like. Nobody gets enough rest, right? Everybody thinks they need more rest. Everybody thinks they need more sleep. And here's what I'm telling you today, friend. You and I have got to find a way to operate outside of that mindset. We've got to find a way to operate outside of this tired, muggy, dreary, worn-down mindset, realizing I've got a job to do. I've got something I need to accomplish. I can't just be tired my whole life. I can't just be out of energy my whole life. Why? Because I've got something I'm living for. I've got to wake up, whether I feel like it or not, and I've got to go about my day because people need to be saved. Amen? People need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And how do they do that if I'm sleeping and not doing again what the Lord has called me to do? Now, I tell you what, friend, sleep is a great thing. Amen? It's wonderful. When you've had a long day and you can go to sleep and wake up rested and all these different things, but I tell you this, it is not the purpose that we live for. I don't live just so I can put my head down on a pillow at night. Amen? Are you the same way? I don't live my life just so I can go to bed at night, but rather, I live for a goal. I live for a cause. Now listen, there is a majority of the people of the world that live to put their head down on a pillow at night. We've talked about some different things that people do just to be able to go to sleep at night, right? Some different beliefs and ideologies that they adapt and they pick up just so they can sleep at night. But I tell you what, we live for something so much more than simply the rest that you and I can accumulate through this life. And then the Bible says this in verse number 13. Let us walk honestly. Let us walk in a different way, in a different life. And then watch what it says in the second part of that verse. As in the day. right? Not in the night, not sleeping, but rather let us walk honestly, as in the day where everything is seen, where everything's above the table, where we're not sleeping and we're not wasting time, but rather we're getting things done. We're being productive with, again, this life that God has given to us. And I tell you what, friend, again, as I just simply remind you of the church and the state of the church, and if we were to go to the verses in the Bible where it talks about being lukewarm, right? He says, I would have you that you be hot or cold, but not lukewarm, right? He talks about spitting them out of his mouth. I tell you what, there's a whole lukewarm Christianity full of sleepy Christians that don't want to do anything. Amen? Can we be really honest for a second? I'm not preaching to any of you. I'm just preaching. Amen? I'm not pointing fingers at anybody. But there's a whole generation of sleepy Christians. There's a whole generation of people that simply want to exist in this sleepwalking state of Christianity that is not serving God, that is not pleasing God, that is not accomplishing anything for the Lord, but rather is simply getting through day to day. You know, I've been trying to stress that point lately, that we're not just getting through day to day. I've mentioned it in different messages. It's been something that's been on my heart now for some time, but it's not enough for you and I to simply get by in life, but rather that we're winning, or rather that we're succeeding, again, for Jesus Christ. That we're going above and beyond what is just expected of us, again, to further the gospel and take it out into this world. I don't want to just sleepwalk through life. I don't want to. You know, I had a sister that sleepwalked. She would wake up in the middle of the night and she'd go and do all kinds of things. And it always mystified us, the things that she would do. There was a hamper, or a basket, I should say, that used to sit in my grandma's house. It was a heavy basket. I can't remember how old I was, 13, 14-year-old boy. I had to carry it down like this because it was so heavy. And I remember one night, we woke up and that basket was in the sink. And I'm thinking, how in the world did that basket get in the sink? And then we found my sister, not in her bed, sleeping somewhere else in the house. She just laid down and fall asleep. She sleepwalked and she picked up that basket. I don't know how she did it, put it in the sink. But she used to sleepwalk everywhere, right? She'd come downstairs and we were sleeping in different things. And she would sleepwalk everywhere. And I tell you what, friend, that is the same thing that so many Christians in our world are doing right now, is in a haze or in a daze or whatever you want to say, walking through life, not getting anything done, not accomplishing anything, just wasting time waiting for that rapture, waiting for the moment that they're redeemed, but again, not accomplishing anything. And I tell you what, friend, for you and me, that's not acceptable. If you've read your Bible and you've got the Holy Spirit inside of you, that's not acceptable. I can't simply live a life where I'm just sleepwalking, but rather I've got to wake up and get something done because of what Jesus has done for me. And so here's again is the mindset, or here's the challenge again, if you would say, for tonight is this, that you and I are accomplishing something in this life, that we're doing something in this life, not simply sleeping, not seeking rest, not sleepwalking, but rather that we see, we wake up, as the Bible puts it, what's really going on. And I don't know if you've ever been around somebody that's sleepwalking, or you've ever seen somebody that's sleepwalking, but what happens as soon as they wake up in the middle of sleepwalking? You ever been around somebody sleepwalk? You wake them up and they're always scared, right? They're always frightened, or something happens. Maybe you have to jolt them. My sister was really hard to wake up. You'd have to get a hold of her and kind of shake her sometimes. Or I know some people that really get in those sleep trances and have all kinds of fits and different things. And you've got to be really careful how you wake those people up. But what happens? They realize, what in the world's going on? Where am I? What am I doing, right? And here's what we need to do, is wake up and realize, what in the world am I doing? Where am I going? What's my direction? What's my purpose? What's being accomplished by my life? Because I tell you this, friend, if you're just warming a pew, we could get space heaters to do that. Amen? If that's all you're doing, let's put a space heater in here. Let it warm the pews. Listen, we've got to do more than that. If you're simply getting through, why in the world do you have the Holy Spirit of God inside of you? Well, why do you think He imparted it to you? Not that you just keep it and hold on to it, but that you'd be giving it to other people. And so here's the message for tonight is this, friend, wake up. Wake up and stop sleeping. Wake up and realize that you're not just living to go to sleep at night, but rather you've got something to accomplish in your day. And you know what? Sleep can wait. Amen? Sleepiness and tiredness, all that stuff can wait. Why? Because there's people all around us that need the gospel of Jesus Christ that don't have time for you and me to sleep. Now, don't take this from the message. Don't go home and say, Pastor said I can't sleep more than 7 hours. I did not say that. Don't go home and think that I'm preaching at you for going to sleep. Go to sleep tonight. Get a good night rest. Wake up and do your job. Amen? Wake up and tell people about Jesus. But here's what I'm saying is that the general state in life that we're living in is not this sleepwalking, lukewarm, nasty, backwashed. Listen, friend, it's everywhere. But you know what? Just because it's everywhere doesn't mean that it was God's design for how his church ought to be. Amen? And so here's what God's church needs to do. Wake up. Wake up. Get up. Get up out of bed and realize what's going on all around you and realize that you've got a job to do. And here's my last statement, and we'll pray and we'll be done. I know this. If we all realized and if we all understood, again, just how important each and every soul was, our Saturday morning outreach would be packed. Our outreach at this church would be phenomenal. We'd be everywhere, in and out. We'd be all over. Somebody once said this, 5 seconds in hell would do you better than 5 years of Bible college.
Amen.
Listen to that one. 5 seconds in hell would do you better than 5 years of Bible college. I think that's true. You know why? Because if you and I realize how real hell... Why do you always talk about winning souls, preacher? Is there another topic? Listen, people are dying and going to hell every day. And if you and I realize just how severe that penalty was, I think that we'd probably pick up and do something about it. I think we'd probably realize the bus is coming, we're late, get up out of bed, run to the bus. I think we'd want to do something about it. Why? Because the Lord's coming back. He's coming back. And I tell you what, you can't push him back. You can't ask for more time. He's coming when he's coming, and that's it. So you and I have got to be ready for it, prepared for it. But listen to this, awake and watching, waiting for the Lord. How different would the story have been if the disciples were awake? How different would it have been if they were praying for Jesus while he was praying? If they were awake and ready to receive him, how different would it have been if there were people there to support him, right, in his hour of need? But that's not what happened. The disciples were sleeping. They were giving in to the flesh. And then notice what it says, and I'm done. The spirit indeed is willing. What does the Bible say? But the what is weak? The flesh. That's what the Bible says. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And I tell you what, friend, our flesh is weak. Our flesh is carnal. Our flesh is disgusting. But I'll tell you what, listen, we've got to train this flesh to understand and to know what's truly important. That is the spiritual things, not the fleshly things. And so we've got to work hard. We've got to work hard. And it doesn't always mean that we're comfortable. Sometimes we've got to give up on that sleep. Amen? Sometimes when I know I've got something to do and I've got to get up and study early in the morning, hey, listen, don't feel bad for me. I've just got to do it. Amen? It's just something I've got to do to be prepared for my day. Sometimes you've got to stay up late and get things done. Listen, it's just something that we've got to do to get through for the Lord. Amen? And that's our duty. That's our job. And so here's the charge for tonight is this. Wake up. Wake up. Don't be sleepy. One third of your life is sleep. That's enough, friend. Don't give any more to sleep. Amen. But rather to the Lord, let him use that time that we've got. And let's do this. Let's accomplish something through Victory Baptist Church. We look through to 2021. Let's accomplish something in 2021. Let's set a goal and let's accomplish souls being saved. Let's accomplish this church growing again because we're not sleeping, but rather because we're awake. Amen. And every head bowed, every eye closed. Let's pray. You stand. We'll pray. Lord, I know, again, that we talked about tonight a fleshly topic, a topic that pertains to our carnal man and one that we don't like to talk about a lot. Sleep is so valuable and so, precious to some of us, again, because of how little some of us get it and different things. But, Lord, our flesh is weak, as the Bible says. Lord, sometimes we seek sleep or we seek rest and we seek all these things, but we don't seek your work and we don't seek the things that we need to be seeking through this life, but rather just rest for ourselves. Lord, when we really need to look at how you served and what you did, and Lord, you were so busy helping the multitudes. You had to find places and times just to sneak away and to get whatever rest you could. And Lord, you spent your life serving. Lord, the same way that you spent your life, I'm going to spend my life. I want to spend my life serving you and accomplishing something with this life that you've given to me. And Lord, I know this to be true, that if I'm sleepwalking, if I'm simply getting through life, that's not going to happen. And so, Lord, for this church tonight, I pray that you'd wake us up. I pray that you'd open our eyes. I pray, God, that you'd bring an urgency to our hearts that we realize we need to be about your work. Lord, we don't just go out and win souls because we're close to your return. We go out and win souls because that's our job, period. It didn't matter if
if you were going to come in 5,000 years, Lord, we'd still be out winning souls fervently, even right now. Why? Because that's your commandment. And so, Lord, help us and give us that boldness and give us that urgency. But God, I pray this for Victory Baptist Church, that we would be a church that is awake, not a church that is sleeping, not a church that is simply getting by, Lord, but a church that is active in your work. And Lord, I want to see souls saved. God, I want to see families and generations changed for your cause, because we were faithful to do our work as God, you were always faithful to come through. So Lord, help us tonight. And God, I pray again that you would challenge us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. There are some that are responding even now, but maybe you need to come and pray. Maybe you've just been sleeping. Maybe you've just been sleepwalking. Listen, friend, it's never too late to wake up. Don't waste any more time. Rather, give it to the Lord. Realize now is the time to wake up. Now is the time to serve. Friend, maybe you just give that to the Lord. Give him your time. Give him your heart. Maybe tonight, I know most of you, I look around and I see familiar faces, good servants' faces, but I'll still say it, maybe you're not saved. Maybe you come tonight, you don't know the Lord. Only you know that, I don't know that. Maybe you need to get that right with the Lord tonight. Would you come and do that? Would you receive Jesus as your Savior and maybe actually wake up tonight and realize that there's something more important than just our flesh? Realize that you need to be saved. Would you come into that tonight if you need to? Whatever it is the Lord is speaking to you about tonight, would you come and respond to Him? I know for me tonight, I need to give more of my time to Him. I need to give more of my life, more of my energy, more of my body. Listen, friend, there's not enough hours in the day to go out and win souls. But yet we waste time doing so many other things. Maybe you just need to come and pray. Whatever it is, would you come? I'm going to bow. I'm going to pray. Give you time to respond. I'll say this, because we've been saying it lately, and it's something I'd like to do. If you need somebody to pray with, I'll have some folks up here with you. My wife is in the front. I'm up here in the front. If you need somebody to pray with you, come. Grab somebody. We'll do that with you. You come. I'm going to pray. Thought we'll close. I don't know about you, but you ever had a day off? Amen. Aren't those days off wonderful and glorious sometimes where you can just relax? Have you ever done this? Have you ever slept way late on your day off? I tell you what, I think of days off and I think about the potential for the day. That's what always runs through my head is what can I do in this day that I have off? And you know what? I've had those days where I've slept in or I've done something and I've just overslept and slept that day away. And I tell you what, when I wake up 10, 11, oh man, that's nasty times of the day that you've slept and realize, man, my whole morning's gone. That whole day is wasted. I realize, man, I've wasted so much time when I could have been accomplishing, I could have been doing. I tell you what, friend, we need to realize that we've been sleeping, and we've been simply getting through life, and now it's time to pick up and do our work. And I tell you this, friend, let's go win as many souls as we can win. We started right now and didn't stop till the Lord came back. I'm sure that we would have waited one more. And so we need to be busy and active in doing the Lord's work. Amen. So let's do this. Let's pray and we'll be dismissed tonight. Brother Vern, would you make our prayers for us, please?
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for the message we've heard tonight. We pray, Lord, that we'll take it and apply it to our lives. Watch over and guide us as we leave here. Help us to be examples for you each day of our life. In Christ's name we pray.
Amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.